Hello, you wonderful people, and welcome to another episode of Not Too Comic Book. This being a show where we're talking about TV shows that are adaptations of comic books. For today's episode, I'm going to talk about the latest episode of Lucifer, the latest episode of Supergirl, as well as the latest episode of iZombie. Like always, if I'm talking about something you want to listen to, you can always look in the description down below. I clue the time when I start talking about each of the respective shows. So for example, if you want to hear what I say about this week's episode of Lucifer, you can skip to what I'd say about this week's episode of Supergirl, and or skip to what I'd say about this week's episode of iZombie. But the first thing I'm going to talk about is this week's episode of Lucifer. A great episode. I love that. Okay, overall, like the aspect of this episode that you could tell, like from the very beginning, that Lucifer was being manipulated. God, I did like that thought of it being like, oh, is it actually one of his brothers? And I love that you even had like Pierce playing into like, oh, could it be one of your brothers? And even has a Minadel thinking, and it's like got Lucifer work. It's like, oh, what if it's him? Especially when everything kind of starts making it seem like it's him. And I even love the fact is that at one point he tries to stay awake for so long because he's afraid if he goes asleep, as you know, he's going to do all this. So he ends up like doing a bunch of drugs, energy drink, partying and stuff like that, even binging on Bones, which the moment that popped up, because I was like, hey, is that David Boreanaz on TV? And it's like, that's Emily Deschanel, this is Bones. I'm like, shut up. I had the biggest smile on my face. I'm like, shut up. They're literally playing a slight episode of Bones inside of Bones. They were even referencing the actor, like the dude in the episode, Matt. Is he actually, did they do an interesting thing of actually getting an actor who actually acted in the show Bones, actually? Because that would have been interesting. I don't know. It might have just been like a, oh, like, this episode happened and you were, I'm curious. Like, if you do know, like, let me know. I'm kind of curious to look that up to know if that was really a thing. Or was it just like a pseudo episode that really never happened? Or maybe they based it on a real episode, but that act, he wasn't really, you get what I'm trying to say. But, I love that he even talked about the fact that he binged on all 12 seasons. It's like, Chloe is Booth while he's Bones. And it's just like, that's totally backwards, but okay. I mean, it's more like Chloe's kind of Bones and... I mean, if anything, it's like, Ella would kind of be Bones, but even then, like, Ella's not Bones. If anything, I guess Chloe would be technically Booth and Bones, to be exact, but nevertheless. But I actually kind of felt bad because it was like, I knew what the episode was going on. You can tell further and further on that, like, oh yeah, like Lucifer's being manipulated. I'm like, oh dude, like all of this is to make him spiral out of control, especially Maze popping up and giving advice to Chloe, basically saying keywords to know make, because obviously she's not committing her, like she's not going full speed ahead when it comes to Pierce. And so obviously like he's trying to push things along. Even Maze even makes a comment of like, oh, it's actually pretty brutal. What you're going to do is like, you're going to get close to Chloe, then once your curse is done, been lifted, you'll die and just poof and disappear and she'll be broken. But for him, it's like, I don't care, as long as I get what I want and that's to die, then I don't care who I have to hurt. All while kind of spiraling around, like, this main plot of this episode, because obviously Lucifer's still thinking it's him, so he's being very aggressive, not sleeping, and it's kind of making him sound and look a little crazy and delirious. And it turns out, like, because the entire plot was about, like, it turns out that all this stuff around Kevin's life, the new guy, because Kevin was trying to get sober so he could get his family back, because he comes from a wealthy family, and he's never really had to pay for any of his crimes, because basically his family would always sweep it under the rug. And so he kind of got, you know, party lifestyle of kind of getting high and stuff like that. But in particular, the killer in this episode ended up being that dude Jeremy. He's a paid actor too. He even paid the dude Matt to kind of stay in Kevin's life to kind of keep him high, keep him off kilter. And that's what, and it's kind of sad. And it's something even Lucifer kind of jumps on him like about, because it's like, you're pathetic. Like this, you talking about you wanted to protect your family. Like this was never your family to begin with. You were hired to play a role, and just so you wouldn't have to give it up. Because, you know, rather than giving it to the man who's trying so hard to get back to this life, be worthy enough to have this life, that to be a dad, to be, you know, back with his ex. Like you killed him for that, because he wanted what you currently have, and you wanted it. You lived it for so long, you didn't want to give it up, a life that was never yours to begin with, you know, that you were playing a role, but you played it too well, and you start liking it. Which, even the way he talks about it, it almost seems like, it wasn't like he really cared that much, the way he was almost talking about it. It was almost like, yeah, like, oh, this lifestyle I've become accustomed to. It's almost like, I don't know, maybe, you know, legitimately, he did kind of step into that role, but it still gave him no right to do what he did. And it just, I don't know, it kind of sucks that things kind of played out the way that they did. I also find it interesting that you have Ella, like, at the very beginning, it's like they have sex in the evidence closet, and then Ella's like, "Oh wow, like do they not know that I mean that closet is like right next to Ella's lab?" And like it starts bumping, and Ella's like, "Okay, get it, Decker." And I'm like, "Oh, that's so weird." But I mean, for Ella, it's probably like all two thumbs up. It's like, "Yeah, Pierce and Decker." It's like, "Yeah, because you're such a cute, adorable couple and everything." I even love that line of like Lucifer being like, "Oh, you got DNA." And she's like, wait, what? I was like, that's such a dirty joke to make. Like, you know, it's like, holy crap, you're insinuating that. That's interesting. But it's like, oh, no, it's just the DNA tag. Still, the fact is that that joke was there and she freaked out like that. It was just kind of interesting to me. But I think, because to me, I think the saddest thing about that situation is that that whole, like, everything playing up to make Lucifer seem crazy, all these little things, the angels saving these people, kind of making him think it's him, that was all Maze's idea. That wasn't even Pierce, that was Maze's idea, and that's what sticks the dagger in even more, because, and it makes sense, because who can know how to destroy Lucifer better other than Maze? Maze has known him the longest. She knows exactly how to break Lucifer. I mean, a lot of people wouldn't know how to, but she knows how to wound him, how to push his buttons in just the right way, making him feel like everything's a manipulation by his dad, because that's all he's kind of... She's like, oh, what's the thing that you care about the most about, more than even Chloe? You. Which, I guess for Maze, it was more like a twofold attack, because it's like, I'm attacking you on the front of Chloe, but also attacking you on the front of you, because you're thinking... Because for Lucifer, his biggest thing is, like, that was the biggest drawback for him losing his devil face and stuff and getting his wings back, because he felt like he was losing his identity. Even if he was branded the devil, it's like, that's who he was. He doesn't want to be shaped into something or someone else just because, you know, because it also, you know, it's like, this is who I am. I don't want to ever be forced to be someone else, to be someone I'm not, you know, so. And it's sad because it's like, Maze would do that to him. I know she's pissed and everything, but the fact is that she would do that. It's so heartbreaking, dude. Like someone that at one point in time you would have done anything for, you would have done anything in your life to defend, to think that you've fallen so far that you, like, you would do that to him. And that's sad, not only to him, but even to Chloe. Like, I don't know, man. I'm curious legitimately when it's all said and done, like, what Maze will do from here, like, because Lucifer, I don't know if Lucifer's going to forgive her for this. Like, yeah, she might be pissed at Lucifer, but the fact is she went, like, yes, I admitted it, like, in the previous episode, it's, like, I get it. Like, his focus has always been on Chloe. It's like, oh, I'm not important. So, like, she just feels alone, but that's still no reason to do what she's done, and it's just like, it's that continuation of, like, she's destroying all the lives around her. Like, she's not trying to. I mean, now you might be making make the argument that she's actively trying to do it, but it's such a shame that she's kind of burning these bridges with the people. And I'm curious to see what Lucifer will do. Will he even, like, go after her for this or not? Because things didn't necessarily... Because I'm in the long run, like, she's not getting what she wanted, and that was a kind of a way back to hell because Lucifer wouldn't take her. But I think what, obviously, the whole, like, oh, Chloe's still more important to you than me, like, that spark, like, because she feels like she's not important to anybody, even though people keep telling her, but she doesn't believe them. Her trust has been so broken that she doesn't believe anything. Like I said, it's just, it's a complicated situation because it's like, I don't know, because it's like, I'm not saying she's not important to Lucifer, but it's like, in her eyes, it's like, I'm not, because I'll always come second fiddle, you know. It's like, we've been through so much together, but even then, it's like, I'm not good enough for you. I'm always gonna be your second choice, essentially. So I don't know whether this is just like, because she was gonna leave before Pierce brought her back, so it's kind of like, is this all just a ploy to get back at Lucifer, or do you plan on extorting one of his feathers to get back home, or like force him? It's like, oh, I've destroyed your life. If you don't take me back home, you thought this was bad. It's going to get much worse. Or is it just kind of like, I don't care what happens next. I've kind of wrecked everything. So, but the fact of the matter is, because when it's all said and done, Pierce had the opportunity. Obviously, like, Trixie was kind of brought in on it too, because it's like, you know, Chloe admitted, like, oh yeah, like, I legitimately like this guy. Because it finally came out between Lucifer and her, because she's like, okay, why do you have such a problem with me and Pearson, and if that's what Linda's suggesting? Which obviously it's because he has feelings for you, but for her, it's just like, I don't, you know, the way he acts, the way he's always pulled himself back, is like, no, obviously he doesn't feel the same way for me, which is like, he really does, but he's scared because he doesn't know what's real. He wants, if there is something between you, because it's like, it's that situation of like, he doesn't want their relationship to change because they have such a nice bond. He doesn't want to wreck it, especially if he knows that any potential feelings she's had for him, like, Like, it doesn't come up, but he does legitimately not just like, he loves Chloe. And on some level, she feels the same way too. It is definitely the bond they have is more than a partnership, but neither one of them is willing to admit it. Like I said, at the beginning, Chloe kind of put herself out there, like their thing back and forth in season two, but she kind of feels like she pulled back because, like, oh, you can't be honest with me. You know, everything's kind of, you know, because she's still in his mindset of thinking, like, all this thing that Lucifer says and does is all part of, like, his, like, oh, this little devil persona that he has, rather than it just being like, no, this is me. I mean, that's also why Lucifer cares so much about Chloe, because she, even with all his flaws and everything, because he feels like he jokingly says it, but he's still able to be him, even though he's just like, oh yeah, I'm an angel, I'm the devil. Well, I'm the devil. I've got these angel wings and stuff like that. He knows Chloe doesn't believe him, but the fact of the matter is, he can still be himself without her judging him and actually caring about him and this bond they've built, you know? So. But obviously he says, like, oh, Pierce isn't who you think he is, and he tries to explain, but obviously Chloe didn't want to listen because she thinks he's just being delusional, and then she admitted, like, oh, I she was about to say, I love, and then she kind of pulls herself back. But you know, she was like near the end of the episode willing to say those words, but Pierce actually couldn't go through with it, and that actually shocked me. Because I thought that situation was gonna play a lot different. I was like, oh man, Lucifer's gonna rush over, he's going go in there, he's gonna beat the crap out of Kane in front of Chloe, and then she's gonna snap, and like either Lucifer gets arrested or gets pushed further away. But it's like, no, he himself turned her away because he couldn't stand the thought of hurting her. Because what, you know, Maze had said it before, it's like, no, it's not right to do that, because he realizes, like, Chloe is legitimately a good person and she doesn't deserve to be used in that way. And Lucifer, seeing Chloe like that, goes to Pierce's place and gets ready to beat the crap out of him. But Pierce goes like, yeah, I couldn't do it. I couldn't do that to her. And what does Lucifer notice? The mark is missing. So the question, I guess it's because the thing is, and I think this might be the thing, just like Pierce's test was doing something selfless, I think. It's that situation. It's kind of, I think, maybe I've made its reference to something else too. It's like The Good Place. Have you ever seen The Good Place? All the good things you do in your life in that system, it's like, oh, like you have to have a good number set of points to get to the good place. Well, basically, every good thing you ever do become doesn't count towards your total when you're doing it for selfish reasons. And ultimately, I think that's what this was. Because everything Kane has ever done throughout his entire life, whether it's trying to help people, this and that, has all been stemming from the selfish reason of like, oh, I'll be able to die one day. Maybe this will help me find a way. Like, he's always been so self-centered and focused on himself. You know, like even the reason why him and Abel got into it in the first place, that you could make the argument that it was selfish. Like, he's never really done anything selfless. Even trying to bring Abel back, like, no. That wasn't to make things better for Abel. It's like, no, that was to make things better for him. It's like, oh, if we squash our beef, then maybe I can be meek. So it's like that. So that's what I think the argument could be made. It's just like, for once, he did a non-selfish thing. He was going to do something extremely selfish, but, he pulled away, either because either one because it is like that, that you know he did one non-selfish thing, or it could be the potential that maybe it's because Chloe already developed her feelings for him, so it did work, which I don't think so. Like, I never thought that was the case. Like, I've never felt like this whole Chloe situation worked. So that's like, it's there in the back of my mind, but I still don't like give it much thought. Or potentially the curse is passed on to someone else. Like, you could make the argument like, oh, God decided to pass it on to someone else. Could be the thing, I don't know. I'm still leaning with one just because he finally did something non-selfish. So, like I said, where do you go from there? Like, because Maze was all about destroying everything, but now it's like, well, things are kind of at a stalemate. You know, is she going to be 100% okay seeing Chloe in the way she is, even though she has such a problem with everything and everyone? Like, will she be able to forgive herself knowing that she played a part in doing that to Chloe? The way, because the way she's making Chloe feel is exactly the same way she felt about the Linda and Amenadiel situation. So will it make her kind of look at things a little bit different? Like, oh well, I made Chloe feel the way I actually feel, whether I want to admit it or not. That's actually how I felt. So maybe that'll make her second guess things. And what about the whole Pierce thing? Was she still ready to kill Pierce or not? Like, what's going to happen to that situation? It's going to get nasty because, like, I think no matter what happens, it might end up being Lucifer ended up being the one who ultimately does it. Because if Lucifer does do it, like, somebody's going to get arrested. It's probably going to be like a finale thing of like killing Cain, and then it's like, oh wait, what did you do? We got to arrest you type of thing. I don't know. I mean, maybe this has something to do with, like, Lucifer getting his wings back. Because really quickly, there's the whole situation with Charlotte. Charlotte kind of starts telling the truth. It's like, oh, how would she react knowing what she knows now? She starts telling everyone. It's like, oh, this and that. Oh, this and that. Kind of being, like, bluntly honest. And she got to Ella, and she's like, actually, you're actually great. And she says it with a little pissed off tone. Because she's like, you're too damn perfect. But she kind of... goes a little crazy. She's like, oh yeah, Dan. I love that she's like, Dan, get in that closet, strip down naked. I'll freshen up and I'll come in the closet with you. He's like, nah, that's not going to happen. Hard cut to him doing it. And it's just super embarrassing and getting caught in that position. Because it's something Amenadal might was scared of, because Linda still doesn't know the fact is that she 100% knows. We only know, like, he only... Because, like, she still doesn't know about the fact that Lucifer, like, told her the truth in a previous episode and also showed Charlotte his wings. So, like, she knows. But now we kind of understand why. I was like, oh, why is she acting like that? It's like, now that she knows her higher power, like, why was she acting like that? It's like, oh, yeah, because now it's like she has two angels by her side. She knows it's like, if anything goes wrong, I can always get flown up to heaven, which Amenadal is like, no, don't work like that. I don't have my wings. Lucifer's not really welcomed in heaven, so there's that. And then also, like, it immediately shut, like, Charlotte down in an interesting way, because it made her go, I haven't changed at all. She goes, because Amenadal was kind of like, who you are, like, being a good person, being the best person you can be, is what gets you into heaven. And then she kind of realized, like, at the slightest deviation, like, I relapsed. I went back to being the same person I was. It's like, I can't change. And it's like, that's so heartbreaking, because she did take all these steps forward. Like, she didn't go too crazy, but she started sliding back into that lifestyle of hers. But it made her think, like, I can't change. Like, I'm bound to go to hell. Like, the fact is that even this slight alteration made me deviate and go back to who I was, backslide so much, speaks volumes. And I'm curious to see, like, what that means. Because for Amenadal, you know he's going to take blame for it, because he's the one that put it, like, she could have been fine, like, if he had done what Linda said and left her alone, that basically now Charlotte's got this mindset of, like, it doesn't matter, you know, she might not even bother trying anymore either, because it's like, no matter what I do, I'm going to go to hell anyway, so she might not even bother trying. Lucifer kind of got her set on a good path, being with Linda kind of eased everything too. But Amenadal, because he's so caught up in everything, trying to complete his mission, doing, you know, yes, he had the best of intentions, but once again, it's kind of the same thing. Was he doing it out of the goodness of his heart, or was he doing it because he thought it would benefit him, because he thought it was along the same, you know, lines as, like, oh, this is some kind of test of mine. So that's something that has to be kept in mind. And I'm curious to see what Amenadal is going to do, because, like, he's going to probably try and remedy this situation. He might go to Linda for help about this, so... I mean, because Charlotte still doesn't know that Linda knows about, like, this whole celestial thing. So I'm curious to see what happens with that. But the reason why I was kind of tying that in is because it's like, well, maybe there is bigger reason why Lucifer has his wings. Maybe it's tied to Cain, you know, because it's something a minute I was like, yeah, Lucifer's not welcome to heaven. He could get to heaven with those wings. So the question is, the fact is that he has them now. Begs the question of, like, once again, is that thing of, like, you know, the Sinner Man kidnapped you and gave you back your wings, that's still something we've never circled back to, like, how he did that. And it wasn't Cain who did it, potentially. So it's like, was it God? Was there some other part? Like, was he not actually the one that kidnapped Lucifer and gave him back his wings? Was it someone else? And then Lucifer and the Sinner Man just took credit for it because it was all part of, like, Cain's plan from the beginning? Was that what that was all supposed to be about? I mean, to be fair, like, you know, Cain kept saying, like, the Sinner Man kind of deviated. He kind of went his own way about things. So it's hard to say. Like, I feel like that's still something we haven't wrapped up completely or going back to completely understand, you know? So, but the thing is, like, if that's not the case, like, maybe Lucifer's supposed to take Cain to heaven. Like, you know, once Cain has learned to kind of put his nonsense aside, maybe when Cain ultimately dies, it's going to be up to Lucifer to take him to heaven, you know? Because, like, Cain wants to pretend like he doesn't feel guilt or anything, but maybe now where he is now, after what he's done to Chloe, I mean, he can die now, but the question is, will he want to after? Will he just be okay with just leaving Chloe the way he did? Because it's like, yeah, I was trying to get close to her to do this, and I would ultimately break her heart anyway, but now I've broken her heart, and it's like, what do I, you know, what does he do? Does he try to fix things? Does he try to pick things up? Because he knows, like, from the very beginning, he never really had those feelings for her. That was all part of a play. I mean, maybe he really does, you know? Because he knows how, because the sad thing is he knows exactly how Lucifer feels about Chloe. Maybe he doesn't. I don't know. Because Lucifer doesn't really admit it. He's always like, no, she's my partner. It's like, no, there's so much more to it than that. You're just not willing to open up. So like I said, I'm curious to see where this all goes, including with the maze. Obviously, you know, depending on whether she still gets what she wants to out of this deal or whatnot. Like I said, I'm very interested to see what goes down in the next episode with all of this. And now moving on to this week's episode of Supergirl, a great episode of Supergirl. It's great to just have Supergirl back in general, but I really like the theme of this episode being kind of very like a very family orientated episode in the sense of it dealing with, you know, the whole aspect of family. Obviously, the biggest aspect is the fact is that Wynn's dad, Toyman, died, as well as his mom, Mary, pops up, who his mom is played by Laurie Metcalf, best known for playing Jackie on Roseanne, interesting enough, considering Roseanne's comeback and everything, too. But also, you know, she plays Sheldon's mom on The Big Bang Theory. So that's kind of interesting. What I also like, too, is, like, his mom being kind of quirky. Like, she'll kind of make some jokes and stuff like that. And obviously, she acts a little weird and a little awkward and stuff like that, which is because, apparently, we learn a lot more about Wynn's situation. Because we learned a little bit here and there about Wynn's family situation. Like, I mean, it can't be easy having, like, villain like Toyman, like kind of a psychopath like Toyman as a dad. But we learn a little bit more about his mom. His mom hasn't been around in like 20 years. She left him alone with his dad, and we kind of learns why. And it's because his mom was like, it's like, yo, you stay away from Wynn or I will kill him. Like, his dad was that far gone. And it's something, obviously, like, Wynn never knew that. But even then, it's like, well, why'd you stay away all that long? Even if he threatened me, we could have gone away. Like, you know, we could have done something. Like, what if you didn't leave? Because I think also in Wynn's mind, it's like, because in his mind, it's like, my mom, like, she kept my dad stable. So maybe in her mind, it's like, maybe in his mind, it's like, if my mom had stayed, like, who knows what kind of good life we could have had, like, the kind of relationship we could have. Like, maybe, you know, inadvertently kind of blaming her for everything, because it could be like, her leaving is why everything kind of fell apart, or our dad finally snapped. And Jimmy was kind of like, you don't want to go down that route of like what ifs, because it's no point in kind of like the past is the past. And like what happened happened, because he dealt with the same thing, too. It's like when his dad died, he kind of blamed his mom, even though his mom worked her ass off for both him and his siblings. It's just because it's that situation of you were here and he wasn't type of situation. But for when he learns from his mom, like, your dad had always been kind of an asshole, essentially. Like, he was always kind of a mean, just terrible person. And it's just she shielded Wynn from seeing that. You know, because she's like, you don't want your son to have to live in terror, kind of like she was. And the reason why she left in the first place was because, like, he would threaten to kill Wynn just because she disobeyed him. Because it's like, he's very controlling and stuff like that. Which is kind of interesting, because it's like, because the way Toyman acted in season one, you saw he was kind of a psychopath, but it's hard to actually think. The fact is that he was like that. I don't know whether it's something that he got better in age with, he was still controlling and stuff like that, but maybe he wasn't as aggressive, aggro when it came. Maybe because Mary stayed away, so maybe that kind of made him go, okay, it's good, Wynn can live. But it's so sad to think that, like, you would do that just because, you know, because the sad thing is, like, she was saying that time that he crashed into him, that moment he threatened Wynn, was when he almost ran them off the road because she was heading to an abuse shelter to get away from him. It's like, dude, that it's rough, you know? And, you know, and that's, and I really think this episode did a powerful job of kind of, like, diving, kind of showing you that other side of Wynn. Because Wynn's kind of, like, you know, obviously he's the nerd. He's the one that kind of helps the team with, you know, his ideas and the tech. And he's kind of like the comic relief in some occasions. But it's like, this, I feel like we got to see like a deeper side to Wynn, and just with his whole family situation, kind of diving into something we haven't tackled since season one. It's like what it means being in the Wynn situation. Because that is something I think I know about Wynn. I remember hearing someone talk about that Wynn in the comic books is a lot different, because I think he does kind of become more like his dad. And that was something I'm just curious to see if they were going to delve into that. Because it's so interesting, because it's kind of, they do it kind of that Luther thing where it's like Lena tries to battle the Luther name. It's like she has Luther blood in her genes. And I'm sure Wynn thinks the same thing. It's like, I have my dad's blood in me. Like, am I going to be like my dad? And that was actually a concern his mom had. But seeing what he does every day, helping people and stuff like that, surrounding himself with great friends, his mom doesn't worry him. It's like, you built a great life. You exceeded my expectations of my hopes and my dreams for you. And his mom says that she wants to leave because she doesn't like he doesn't need her anymore, but it's like, oh, he's still, you know, so maybe we'll see her pop in from time to time. That might be interesting. Like, at least know that she exists within a canon. She might not pop up a lot, but she exists somewhere in a canon. So that's really nice. It was kind of interesting because I was wondering, like, I was thinking the entire time, I was like, oh yeah, Toyman faked his death, obviously. He's still alive and kicking it. It's like, and then there was a part of me is like, don't tell me she came up with all this, like that she's actually just as demented in him as him, and this whole thing is just her way of trying to get Wynn's attention. It's like, no. It's actually someone else. Someone who worked at the penitentiary that his dad was at, like basically his dad's, like I guess the lady was kind of off her rocker already, but Winslow was able to get in her head, and then she was kind of like, oh, all this is her laying out his revenge, because it's like, oh, Mary broke the rules. It's like, you stay away or I'm going to kill Wynn. It's like, well, now my protege is going to handle things, which I do appreciate. I like that aspect that this is something like it hasn't come up that often. Like, I don't remember how many times Toyman popped up in Smallville, but it's a villain that I feel like hasn't really, like, this is like, you know, he's I don't think he's ever popped up in anything. Like, he doesn't seem like he's one of those top tier villains you'd probably see in a movie or something. Like, he's probably like a throwaway villain sometimes, probably. But like I said, I always remember him specifically from the Superman animated series because he wore that giant, like, toy kind of bobblehead thing on top of his head. I don't know if that's like canonical to the character. I'd assume it is, but nevertheless. But I'm wondering on some level, is he actually still alive and that was just kind of all an act and that he's secretly working behind the scenes? I doubt it. It probably really is legitimately that he is dead, but I mean, who knows? So it is kind of nice that it does close one chapter in his door because it still left Wynn feeling conflicted because no matter what the situation, no matter how much of a terrible person he was, that was his dad. And to an extent, it's probably not even a situation of like, oh, he was my dad. I loved him. Maybe at one point in time, Wynn did, but it's also just because it's like everything that's associated with him, it just, you know. It brings back the terrible memories. Because for him, it's like not even just his dad being a terrible person. For him, it all brings back the fact is that he spent so much time, like that time he waited for his mom to pick him up and she never came because she was gone, you know? So I do like her just immediately kind of being like, oh my God, this is what you do every day, saying the day. And even when he got cut at the end, she's like, oh my God, we need to take care of this wound immediately. When's the last time you got your tetanus shot? And he's like, it's up to date, mom. Seriously. It's like she's getting all in mom mode like that. Like I said, she's got this quirkiness to her that I really like. I think they did a really good job because obviously that's a quirkiness that she shares with Wynn, and I think they did a good job showing that. Like, he shows that like he favors his mom a lot too because his mom is very smart too with just the way she handles things. Because she went all badass mode grabbing one of the monkeys. Which, side note, can I just talk about like some of the action in this episode that was so good? Like the slow-mos and stuff, like Kara swinging that pole around and then like heat visioning at the same time. You had Jimmy like punching, like literally at one point he's like Superman punching, jumping in the air and punching one of the robots with bare fists. I'm surprised that didn't hurt more, but yeah, I noticed that. But also give it up to freaking God, Mon-El for that whole thing with the T-Rex later on with the freaking cape. I was like, what? That is so sick. And even Kara's like, how did you do that? Which Kara, he referenced, like, Mono references, well, yeah, the fact of the matter is, my Legion suit had a cape. I was like, oh my God! Because I was halfway expecting him to get that suit last season, because I do know that Mono, like, as Valor, has a specific suit. It's like a red suit. It's actually been a while since I actually looked at it, but, yeah, he has it. It's just it got damaged in the fight. It's like, oh, you have wind there. So most likely that's probably something we won't see until like the very end of the season. I kind of get that feeling. But it's like, yo, that's so dope. Because it's like, yo, you were. It's like she's like, how did you do that whole thing with the cape? It's like, yeah. So she's like, Kara's like, I've always had a cape. I've never done anything like that. So I guess it's just, I guess that's part of his fighting style, apparently, maybe. Cause I thought when he grabbed it, I was like, oh, he's gonna wear it for a little bit, and they're gonna make a joke about it. I'm like, oh, he's like, maybe I should keep this. It's like, no, he already has it. He just doesn't wear his Legion suit. I mean, I wonder, does everyone else have their own Legion suits as well? Like, I mean, that'd be free. Like I said, I just get the feeling like Wynn's gonna fix it, but it's not gonna be till like the tail end of the season. And speaking of that situation, it's kind of interesting too because we finally learned from Mon-El what it is that Imra kept from him. And the real thing that she ended up keeping from him is that Pestilence, one of the world destroyers, is actually an enemy far into the future named Blight. So that this destroyer, which is kind of crazy to me, so that means that this destroyer in some shape or form still exists. Like Like, that must mean that the other two were dealt with, but Blight was, because Pestilence became Blight. So my brain operates on two different levels. One, that means Kara was able to save the other two, but Pestilence either found a way to time travel, left somewhere else, and then came back later on, or it's a situation of like, I don't know, like, that's where my mind comes from. Because the other thing I was thinking about is, it's like, oh, we're going to join forces now. It's like they were not meant to know about this, because I guess the main reason why Imra wouldn't want him to know that was because, like, well, then he wouldn't be all that going back to this time specifically, because she knew that he'd be having awkward feelings about the whole Kara situation, and that's why they kind of kept in the dark. Not just Imra, Brainy kept him in the dark too. Like, this whole situation was to get them back to this point in time so they could deal with this world killer before it becomes an even bigger issue in the future. Which immediately my brain goes, yeah, but we're like, they're going to work together and everything, ha ha ha. But like, immediately you can see the immediate problem being the outcome, because obviously Imra and them are pro. I'm assuming are going to want to kill Pestilence, but Card's not going to want to do that. She wants to save the world killer. Hence why I'm like, the reason why they don't exist in the future, maybe it's because Kara was able to save Rain as well as Purity. I'm blanking on the other one's name. So maybe that's what that's supposed to represent. It depends, you can change the future and stuff like that. So it's just kind of interesting. So maybe this whole Pestilence situation will work out differently, potentially. I don't know. I'm immediately seeing that being an issue. And that'll probably leave Mon-El kind of torn, because it's like, oh, he has the future knowledge and he knows what Pestilence is, as Blight will do. So it's like, hey, we need to take care of this now. But then it's kind of like, Kari won't want to do that way, because it's like, oh, as heroes, that's not what we do. But maybe in the future, to come, like, well, we need to change the future, and we might need to approach things from a different stand. That might be something. And it's like, maybe Mon-El won't be for it, maybe Mon-El will be for it, and maybe it'll kind of split him, because it's like, oh, do I side with Kara, which is Kara's, like, Kara kind of made him into the hero that he is, so kind of like helped mold his morals. Or will he side with, I'm curious to see how that goes out. Like, maybe I'm completely creating a problem that won't exist, but I kind of had that feeling that it will. But ultimately, we'll kind of have to wait and see on that front. Also, when it comes to family, like I said, continuing the family train this episode, we had Alex having dinner with John and his dad, which was nice. It was lovely, because you even had, like, John's dad commenting on the fact of the matter is, it's like he sees what John's kind of built for himself, surrounding himself with friends, and those friends treating him like family, not just treating John like family, but even treating his dad like family. And he's like, he's grateful for it. But then Alex started noticing little things here and there, like about his memories. It's like, oh, like in one moment, it's like he actually forgot he had grandchildren. And it's like, oh, like Alex knew exactly what's going on. That basically he was losing his memories, kind of essentially what on Earth would be the equivalency of dementia was happening to him. Which is not a foreign thing. It seems like it's a thing that happens to Martians as well. They have their own specific word for it. And so Alex wants to tell John, because it's like, oh, he deserves to know. But, John's dad kind of gets pissed, because it's like, no, you're not going to tell him anything. He's my son. I'm going to be the one to decide what he gets to know. Because for him, it's like, my son went through so much. He brought me here, and like, he's already taking care of me so much. The last thing I want to do is become even more of a burden on him, take him away from his life, taking so much away from him that he has to focus on me. So eventually he tells John the truth, because I think it didn't sit right with him, because he's like, because I think in the end he kind of realized, like, he had no right to kind of really yell at Alex like that. Like, it's just a situation of, obviously he's a little scared himself, because it's like, I finally got my son back after all this time, and I'm just going to end up losing him again, and he finally got me back, and he's going to lose me when it's all said and done. So, because Alex did talk about the fact is that it could be potentially dangerous. Let's not forget, he is a Martian too, so that could lead to danger all on its own in many different shapes and forms. So it is not the easiest thing to handle. Like, whereas we have one nice side of family, like, oh, you have a reunion. On the other, we kind of have like kind of a sad story playing out with another family. So seems like obviously he'll have his friends and the people he considers family there to kind of help him, through this him and his dad through this tough time, trying to maybe find something that might be able to help or slow it down potentially. I don't know. But also popping up in this episode is the whole situation with Jimmy. The fact is he kept calling Lena kind of made me go like, oh man, something must be up. Lena's not answering. Lena's not answering. Oh, this isn't good. This isn't good. And she picks up at the end of the episode and I see her in a lab. I'm like, oh, don't tell me like she's using Cadmus Labs or something, but your mom's locked up, isn't she? I mean, the fact of the matter, she'll end up breaking out eventually at some point, just what she normally does. But I'm like, is that what that's supposed to be? It's like, no, she's taking care of Sam. Because the fact, I guess Lena's not letting anyone know, because like, I guess she doesn't want to worry anybody until she gets a definitive answer on what's going down. So, because obviously Jimmy knows that she's kind of lying, but he doesn't know why she's lying. But it's like, obviously, it's like, I was worried. I was like, oh man, it's like, no, she's lying for good reasons, because she's trying to take care of Sam, but she doesn't want anyone to know. Because the last thing she wants is probably get like, even someone like Kara, or Alex kind of worried about this whole situation, so she's keeping it hush hush. Because she, like I said, last time we saw, like, she saw like Sam's whole situation, so she knows it's not just a normal situation. So she's, well, once again, it's like when Sam turned to her, like, she saw Sam's eyes change color, so like, she definitely knows it's more. So she's probably using all her resources and tech to kind of make sure that things are okay. So that was like a pretty nice, plot kind of like forwarding element. Obviously, like I said, we learned a little bit more about pestilence too. So, what I'm also interested about too is obviously the conversation comes up again about the whole Kara and Mon-El situation, because it's like, yeah, see you later, buddy. All right, buddy. They're still being super awkward around each other. And yes, I do understand where Kara was coming from. Like, yeah, don't talk to me about Imra, your problems with Imra, which is like, yeah, I understand. Like, but it's like that's not fair on Imra's behalf or mine, because it's like that's kind of just a tough subject. And obviously, I had a feeling that wasn't what Mon-El wanted to talk about, but I think it was still something that needed to possibly be said. But it's probably makes the conversation still a little awkward with even considering that. So the fact is that they're still like that, like, oh, buddy, like you can tell there's something there. But at the same time, it's like, I'm curious, like, because it makes you wonder, like, legitimately, like, where does Mon-El's heart lie? Does, like, obviously he cares very deeply for Imra, but the whole conversation is though, like, is he just like, and I think I'm pretty sure it's been a little while, but earlier, a few episodes back, that's what actually came up, wasn't it? Like the whole thing of like, oh yeah, like, is he staying with Imra out of obligation because she is his wife and everything, because he never thought there was any going back to Kara. So is he staying with Imra out of obligation? But obviously he cares for her too. So, it's that complicated situation. So, like I said, just, I don't know, some other interesting things to kind of just think about and keep in mind about like their whole dynamic and where it all will end with them. Like I said, my thought process is still that when it's all said and done, he'll still go back to the future, So that's where he belongs, and Kara's here where she needs to be. So, like I said, ultimately we'll have to wait and see though. Like I said, potentially in this recording, because I actually don't remember, because yes, I think I did say it in this recording. Like I said, hopefully we might get to see more of Mary, but probably won't be. It'll probably just be like oh yeah, I might reference her here and there. Like I said, at least knowing that she exists in the canon is potentially good enough, I guess, so. But we'll just have to wait and see what the next episode has in store for us. And now moving on to this week's episode of iZombie, another great episode. In this episode, we have Liv eating the brain of a dude named Max, who's basically a wingman slash kind of pickup artist. It's kind of a douchebag, because it's a whole like, oh yeah, basically tear a woman down so that, and then you kind of really, it's scummy crap. But it's so interesting when you see Liv having to like have those brains in her system and kind of have to shake it off and everything. The fact of the matter is, literally one of my favorite lines that got me was her being like, well, all that sex talk has got me horny, so if Robbie asks where I am, tell him I took off early to go tap some ass. And I just love that Clive just, he's just kind of like, oh God. And obviously it's even more cringy because like Liv has to be so disgusting about it, because she's just like, oh yeah, I'm nagging, tear a woman down just to, like I said, the whole process, it's just so interesting. I love that Robbie, because it's so sad, because Clive tried to be on Tinder and everything secretly, and Peyton's like, Clive, are you on Tinder? And then Robbie's like, oh, gets all excited and everything, and it's like, yeah, it's like, Because this is actually when they find out the truth. Like, because I was like, because I was like, I actually caught me on guard. Because like, oh, they actually don't know. Because the only person that knows about his relationship situation is, God, I'm blanking on it. Michelle, the cop, and Liv. And so this is the episode where Ravi and Peyton found out. And they're like, oh. And Ravi decides to be his wingman and everything. I think I remember specifically just that I don't. The case sounds familiar, but the one he was referencing when he was talking to the ladies at the bar, like Clive was talking about, oh, the most messed up thing he saw in a case. And that was like, he was referencing that. I think I remember a specific case. Wasn't that like a season? Was it a season two case? I feel like that might've been a season one case. I don't remember. But I, like the whole like AC unit falling on someone. That sounds super familiar. That might've been season two. I don't remember. Nevertheless, turns out they had boyfriends. They have Liv pop up because they were like, okay, with the brain Liv is on right now. Yeah, we agree. Don't tell her where we're at. And it's like, yep, she shows up anyway. And Clive doing what he did. Like, he doesn't want to trick people into having sex with him. So he like was upfront. And like, one of the ladies was like very sympathetic. Like, oh my God. Like, and then he found out about like, you know, the influenza cure vaccine, you know, and now she's a zombie. It's like, oh, he sat over there and explained the situation about what was happening. And then Robert's like, oh, I'm going to go have sex with my girlfriend. And then, like, I was like, oh, don't be gross about it. But also my favorite bit is the whole situation with Levon, because he was like, I'm not going to sleep with you when you're on this brain and stuff. And then later on, she opens up to him and stuff like that. Like, obviously, she's like, hey, the douchebag brain wore off and everything. And she kind of talks about the fact is that, like, oh, yeah, these different brains kind of, you know, her job, because she's always on so many different brains, has a tendency to influence her personal life. Which, to be fair, it's only influenced it once in a negative way, and that was Justin last season. That was the first time that it ever happened, because previously to that, like, it's been okay, like, because, like, obviously at those given times, like, her significant others, like, whether it be Lowell or Drake, were in the same situation as her, so, but I thought, so it's fascinating, was, like, the fact is that she kisses him and everything, and he's like, well, what are you doing? He's like, you're actually still on that brain. And she's like, you know, you'll have to be, because he's kind of like, yeah, I'm kind of a girl. And the fact is that I kind of want to, you know, want the first time to be special with someone I like. And she's like, yeah, you are such a girl. He's like, I feel so cheap. Just get out. And it's just like, oh, that sucks. I was halfway believing it the way she was at it. Oh, I guess you're not on a brain anymore. This is a sweet moment. And it was immediately ruined like that. It was so good. So obviously going back to it, we find out this main case is all about, we end up finding out that the killer is that Lady Zoe. Because obviously being the way he operates, Max is kind of a douchebag. Like I said, the whole way he operates and does everything, misogynistic, the usual type of thing. But the reason why Zoe ended up killing him is because he ended up talking to the guy. He trained the dude, George, who ended up turning her. Which is an interesting thing, because I feel like they never outright bring that up. There's the whole, like, oh, zombies and humans don't have sex. I mean, maybe they brought that up early in the show. I just don't remember that exact conversation ever coming out. It was just kind of like, it doesn't happen. Like, I know, like, with the zombie thing, it's like, well, just one scratching your zombie. So I know that's always, like, a fear. But I guess in my mind, I just never thought about the whole aspect of, like, well, there's probably that, and probably exchanging of bodily fluids will probably do that as well. But it just never correlate in my head that was, like, I don't know. It just never came up. I feel like this is the first time they've ever outright been, like, yeah, sex with a zombie would turn you, like, into a zombie. It's kind of like an infection. Which is kind of weird to think of, like, having, like, zombieism be almost treated like a transmittable disease, like an STD or STI, whatever the case may be. It's just kind of interesting that it gets treated like that. But basically what George was saying is that, like, oh, Zoe, that's not her real name, but just for the purpose of what we call it, Zoe was like, oh, yeah, she wanted to know, was like, oh, she's a bug. Those who kind of get off on, like, oh, trying to see what it's like to be with a zombie. But it turns out that's not the case at all. Zoe, like, had no idea that George was a zombie. He you know, it's most likely a situation of like, oh, he said what he needed to say just to kind of sleep with her, kind of the whole class that Max taught. And then, like, when it went to court, he, like, lied on the stand and kind of made it seem like it was all Zoe's fault. So that's what motivated her to do this. Obviously, like, you have George being locked up for a while. I love that he's like, oh, what year is it? And you have Chase being like, dude, it's literally only been a month. You still got a little while before we get to 2023. So that's kind of interesting, because kind of already sets their emotions, like, kind of getting like a little timetable on how like long punishments are kind of held in this regard. But nevertheless, so for her, she doesn't mind doing what she did. She'll go to jail, like even not, well, not jail. She's fine with being put on ice for this situation because that means a man like Max can't do this to any other woman because he ruined her life. Because by making her a zombie, she no longer has the option of having kids or having a normal life. Her entire life was ruined the moment she met Max, and he didn't like can't have some, like an asshole like him out there ruining other people's lives essentially. So it's actually a very sad reason. I mean, it's just like, it's never a good reason to murder somebody, but it's just kind of like a sad, and like you understand why she did what she did. Like, he, you know, like doesn't justify it, but it's just kind of like, it's just, it's sad that things kind of played out that way for her. Also in this episode, we learned about the whole really quickly before I even get to that, Liv looking the way she does. I'm like, so that's going to be something we see a lot more throughout the season, which is kind of going to be interesting because it just means that Rose McIver has to look more like herself on set, which is going to be interesting. Obviously, she's going to have to still put on makeup on everything like that, but it's still kind of interesting just because like it's something that pops up every once in a while. But for Liv, she's kind of like more all natural a lot of the times. But it's just so interesting to see her kind of being like that from now on. It seems like that's just going to be her regular thing. I guess she feels like if she sticks out as a zombie, it's going to draw a lot more attention to herself. So she wants to kind of fit in and blend in with the crowd, especially with her doing this whole like railroad, like, you know, Mama Leone thing. Like, so it, like the less attention she draws to herself, the better. So, which interestingly enough, I'll put it out there, is kind of along the same lines. She actually met Angus this episode. And then I was like, the fact is, I was like, oh, I can't wait for her to realize it's Angus. And I was like, right, you two have never actually met. And I was like, oh man, she doesn't even know that that's Blaine. I was like, but he was like, oh, you can get some brains at Romero's. And so she's like, oh yeah, I actually know someone at Romero's. Like, oh yeah, do you know my son? Yeah, that's my son, Blaine. And she's like, Blaine is your son? And he's like, yeah, and he's single. And just kind of like, you know, that's like a big no-no for Liv. The fact of the matter is, even on her brain, that she still would, like, even in that situation, even she wasn't kind of like, oh. Well, we do know that Liv texted like 10 different dudes about, like, the whole, like, down to duck. One being that other detective at the precinct, which is kind of like a, ugh. It's like, do you know why Liv texted me that? Because now I'm in trouble with my wife. Which obviously they get their brains shady reasons though. I mean, obviously last time we saw, like, they killed quite a bit of zombies who were kind of getting brains illegally, brain tubes illegally, and they ended up taking it. It's like, oh, we get them from donations, which I don't know if that's true at all. But also, like, oh, some brain tubes that fall through the cracks. I can assume those cracks are the cracks you live in people's skulls when you kill them and take their brain tubes. Now, to be fair, we saw that one time. Who's to say they've done it subsequently since? Plus, with the situation with Blaine, they are getting those on in a weekly situation now, potentially, until Blaine remedies this situation. I do appreciate that Donnie, I wasn't expecting it. I was like, oh, there's that dude. I was like, oh, I guess he doesn't know that the whole Angus situation about, and all of a sudden you just see Donnie running up off a sword and he's like, yach! And cuts the dude's head off. So that's never popped up before in the show, has it? Like zombies kind of being dismembered like that. It has, hasn't it? I swear that's come up before. Maybe not. Well, I know Blaine's had his throat slit by Mr. Balls. I know that was it, but like completely decapitated? I don't think that's ever come up before. So that's why I was wondering. I was like, oh, like, I've still always been wondering about like how far zombieism like takes you in that regard, like how your body regenerates and stuff. Like, I mean, if you sat his head back on top of his body, would it naturally heal? I mean, I don't know. Maybe so, I don't know. Nevertheless, I do love that, like, Donnie brings up his old buddy. He's like, yeah, my old buddy was a real, he's like, miss you every day, chief. I was like, all right, you mute, buddy. It's like, right. And I was like, oh yeah, I'm gonna mail your head to Gwyneth Paltrow. She'll like it, right? She'll laugh about it. It's like, yeah, I don't know. It's just kind of, I love them just being idiots. I'm curious to see what Blaine will do to him, like, in the end. It's like, yeah, you betrayed me, and you did the worst thing, you let my dad free, and now he's back to being more of a pain in the ass. And, because not only is he being a pain in the ass to me, he's also interfering with my business. That's another thing. You're messing with my moolah. So I'm curious to see how Blaine handles that situation. But the thing I was going to get to earlier is the whole situation with, Clive. He met with that lady. I was like, oh man, maybe this isn't what I think it is. Maybe it's like they're painting it like Clive's sleeping with the lady, but he's not. But in fact, he was. Turns out lady was a lady of the night, which is kind of interesting because that did not seem like Clive. But what makes that situation even sadder is because we learn from Bozzio, like, she's been on dates with dudes and kissed some dudes, but she hasn't actually slept with anyone Clive doing what he did, sleeping with a prostitute, was the first time. So basically, she's like, I guess this is where we are right now. Like, so that's probably why her reaction was what it was, because she probably heard Clive when he was talking to Michelle, like learning that, oh, he hasn't really done this before. So probably that combined with every time being with some dude, it just made her want to be with Clive even more. So it's just sad because it's a complicated relationship. And now it's like their relationship is definitely pushing that open relationship aspect even more. And you see it leaves Clive feeling heartbroken because he's like, I don't want to be that guy. I didn't want to be that guy. But I thought I had to be that guy to satisfy my needs. And I thought this is kind of a relationship we were in and stuff like that. Plus, at the time, he was off, you know, getting drunk with Ravi and Levin. I guess it just, he wasn't in the right mindset to make the right decision. So it's just kind of sad. Maybe if he had talked to Basio before now, he probably would have learned the truth. I mean, like I said, it still doesn't remedy the situation of like, man, that's still a complicated situation, which could either end with Clive becoming a zombie, which he doesn't want to, or potentially getting Basio one of those 15 remaining cures. So ultimately, we kind of have to see where things kind of go from here with their relationship. So then you had the whole situation of Chase. It's kind of interesting because it's like, because Major asked him, but we never get an answer. It's like, why are you checking your, do you have a reason for checking for bugs in office? He's like, yeah, I do. And it's like, I guess he's worried about somebody. I guess he's worried about just anyone in general bugging his office, trying to figure out stuff. I mean, to be fair, you did kidnap like a general's daughter. So maybe that plays into it. Or maybe it's just stuff at Fillmore Graves. Because he is talking about the fact is that people will just kind of like try and like take him out. You know, he's gotten warned, like, people will try and take you out if this whole zombie situation, people going unfed type of situation continues. So maybe he's thinking like some of the people that work at Fillmore Graves is trying him. That I don't know what his thought process is right now currently with all of that, but he has made it Major his vice president of getting stuff done. He's like, yeah, he's actually higher ranked than all of you because he actually gets stuff done. So now he has to be friends with that dude that's selling stuff, because it's like, he's just the bottom of the barrel. We've got to find out who he works for, which is like, we haven't seen that yet. So far, it's just been like that Roach dude being like the only one that's like, we've really seen like selling the tubes and stuff like that. So we don't know how far this goes up in the food chain, interestingly enough. So I'm interested to find out who is behind all of that. Which that whole situation leads to Major kind of like being a little more dickish this episode, because he's trying to side more so with him to kind of get buddy-buddy so he can get closer to this whole situation, which involved them because Chase wanted them to shut down a newspaper because this newspaper was kind of showing Mama Leone as a martyr. But it's like, the fact of the matter is I killed that lady because she was making this proper situation that was already sucky in Seattle. She was making it worse by making new zombies with zombies we already have that can't be fed. And it's just like, it is just, we are literally one mistake away from being nuked and wiped out completely. So that played an aspect into it. So interestingly enough, it's the same newspaper that I'm blanking her name. We met her last season. She was the one that was kind of helping figure out the whole thing about zombies and stuff last season. When all those people, like the bad guys in season 3 were gathering, the ones that were all about taking out zombies. Like, oh, zombies are really out there. People just don't know. That whole situation last season, she was like the reporter. Like, that was kind of interesting that it kind of tailored back to that in this particular episode. And she's like, oh, like, what's, oh, that's to be expected, a chaos killer. He's like, that's my name. Major being playing the dick road is like, that's my name, baby, don't worry. Which, once again, I have to point out, doesn't he get any slack from that? Because it's like all his quote unquote victims are still alive, and we now know that we're zombies and stuff like that. But I guess not. That chaos killer. And what about that girl he met? Wasn't that last season? The girl that made all those t-shirts about him being the chaos killer and stuff like that. Like, I'm curious to know if she ever pops back in the story. There's actually another case that might have been like season 1 or season 2. I think it might be related to that AC case. Isn't that the one that the killer got away and she left town? I've always been wondering about that story. There was like some case that where the killer was a lady. I think it might have been that one that Clive was mentioning that the show has never circled back to because she just got away with it and just left Seattle. So I don't know if that's something they ever plan on circling back to. But I don't remember. I can't remember the specifics of the case. It was just an interesting thing that I've always kind of expected it to come back around to. But nevertheless, so Peyton and the mayor show up and Chase kind of talks about things more about like, you know, the situation being the way it is, and it's like, oh, if people making zombies, if he finds out people are doing that, they will be severely punished. Which then immediately ends with the episode of Liv being caught by Peyton, because Peyton catches her making like fake IDs, which I'm like, why would you do that out in the open like that? Liv, she got headphones and everything on. I guess she just wasn't expecting Peyton to stop by. But I'm also curious because like Peyton was kind of seeing the look on Major's face like during the whole conversation, like Major didn't want to be a part of that situation, but it's because kind of like he chose his side and he just kind of has to stick with it, kind of essentially suck it up essentially. Which also, like, kind of along the same lines, I'm like, Peyton's like, what are you doing? Hard cut to the end of the episode. Which is definitely going to be interesting to see how Peyton reacts, because obviously she's in that, like, you know, close to the mayor and everything. Plus, she knows, like, she was literally there with Liv and Ravi when they saw what happened to Mom and Leonie for doing this exact thing. And it's like, you know, and it's something I brought up before, the reason why Liv hasn't told anyone, because potentially they would stop her, because, you know, they wouldn't want her to get hurt. Like, they'd understand why she's doing what she's doing, but at the same time, it's like, I don't want to see you get killed, and you will get killed for this. Also, like I said, because of the position Peyton's in, too, so there's that aspect. But it's kind of interesting, because Clive kind of has her back a little bit, because there's that whole donut situation, which was pretty smooth on her part. It's like, oh, yeah, you got those donuts? It's like, do you really need another donut? But Clive kind of touched the box. I was like, no, some people back at the station might want it, so don't. He had a feeling that Liv was up to something. Opened the box, I was like, oh, there was nothing in it. And it's like, huh. Even Clive was kind of like, okay. Even I was like, wait, what? Where'd you hide it then? And it's like, oh, yeah, the hat. So that was the whole point of the hat the entire time. That was kind of pretty neat to hide the device to make the fake IDs that they needed. But even Clive asks, is there anything I should be worried about? Like, I know that you were up to something. And she's like, maybe it'd be better if you didn't know. Which is like, which Clive knows that, yes, there is more, but he probably won't ask questions. But eventually, it's going to get to a point he is going to have to ask questions. I think that's probably how this is all going to play out. Like, I think I talked about that, like, last episode. But, like, I do believe Liv is going to get caught, and it's probably going to take everything and everyone to try and get her out of it. I think eventually she will be caught as, you know, renegade and tried and everything. So, I don't know. Like I said, Major was kind of on the sidelines during the Mom and Leonie situation, but it's going to be different if it's Liv in that situation. So, I don't know, like, some very interesting developments all around with everything. So, I'm very interested to see what goes down in the next episode. But really, that's all I want to talk about. Till the next time we meet, be happy, be safe, love out to the fullest, and enjoy it. Good day, and goodbye.